Okay, so today we are going to talk about Harry Potter and the Chamber of Secrets, and more specifically, the parts of the book that don't quite fit together just right. If you're new to this series, just to clarify, I love this series very much. I've read it 10 plus times. I read it every year growing up, and I've read it several times as an adult, and it's an awesome experience. I also just yesterday put up a very positive review of this book. Even though it's my least favorite in the series, I still enjoyed reading it. I'll link it in the corner and down below. And as much fun as I have talking about how awesome this series is, I also really enjoy digging a little bit deeper and talking about the things that aren't perfect about it. It's just fun to pick apart your favorite series and see that it's not perfect, but you still love it. Anyway, with this one specifically, this is the book that I call Harry Potter and the Plot Conveniences, because whoa, are they there! So with this book, I'm going to specifically start talking about the things that don't quite make sense, don't quite fit just right, just like I did in the first book. I'm gonna start with the big ones, we're gonna move on to more, just, you know, it doesn't really matter, it's just it doesn't quite work. And then we will move on to the list of plot conveniences, specifically all targeted at the end. So starting off with the two big ones, both revolving around the basilisk, and that is, how did no one see or hear the thing? Hear me out. We'll start with seeing it. It's even brought up in the text. I believe it's Ron that asks the question, how is no one seeing this monster that's attacking people? And then it's never brought up again and never resolved. How is no one seeing this? There are attacks that take place all throughout the school. The first one is right outside of the girls' bathroom where we know the entrance of the Chamber of Secrets is. That one, legit. But then after that, it gets more and more ridiculous. This snake is big. I mentioned this in one of my previous Harry Potter videos, and a lot of people had a problem with me calling the basilisk large, but it is. The book says that it's as wide as an oak tree and extremely long. We don't really get a frame of reference for that. So it's a big creature. We know this. I get that the basilisk is roaming the halls when not a lot of people are around, but there are multiple attacks and they take place in different locations throughout the castle, and I find it difficult to believe that it exits the girls' bathroom and then slithers all around the castle and not a student, teacher, or ghost spots it once without being petrified. You only have to look in its eyes. What if you just hear the slithering or hissing and you step outside the classroom and hey, there's a giant basilisk going that direction, facing away from me? No one noticed? Not even the ghosts? And then you've got the hearing problem. So this is a little bit more of a blatant problem because Harry hears the snake talking about how bad it wants to eat everybody. Which, bumsky, it never gets to eat anybody. Maybe that's a poor choice of words. I guess I just mean, it's wild to me that the snake always leaves its prey. It talks about how bad it wants to eat people because it's so hungry. And then it petrifies this kid on the steps next to the hospital and then leaves. Why didn't she eat the kid? But that's not the point. The point is, why didn't anybody hear it? Harry hears it talking about how bad it wants to kill people, and then no one else does. Even when Ron and Hermione are with him and he can hear the words through the wall, Ron and Hermione don't even hear the hissing. But we know that you can hear hissing when a snake is talking. We know that from when Harry was talking to the boa constrictor at the zoo. We know that from when we were at the dueling club chapter and there was a snake talking and Harry talking back when Harry told the snake to back off and everybody thought he was egging it on. And we know that from future books when we go into the memories of Voldy's family and they're hissing to each other, according to the people that can hear, but no, they're talking parcel tongue. The point is, why did no one hear the hissing? Even the people that were with Harry when Harry heard the hissing translated to words. These are big things that bother me. Now onto the little things that don't really bother me, they just exist. Going back to the beginning of the book, it's always kind of bothered me that Hermione doesn't make more of an effort with Harry when he's with the Dursleys. Like for instance, she's a muggle-born. She knows how to use a phone, how to use public transport. We don't really know how far Hermione lives from Harry. She may not live realistically close enough that she could go and visit him, but we do know that she knows how to use a telephone. And especially in book two, when Harry is not answering any of their letters and they're concerned about him and they're gonna go break him out, why didn't Hermione say, let me give him a call first? I understand that Harry doesn't give Ron and Hermione his phone number until the end of book two, but also there's this thing called a phone book and she knows that he lives with the Dursleys and she knows where he lives, so she could have looked it up. Anyway, moving on to the next thing, Speaking of using owls for communication, maybe this belonged in the first video, and I should have put it in the first video, but I opted not to because I didn't want to talk about too many things. But it came up again in this book, so now let's talk about it. So Mr. Weasley is talking to Harry at this point when he's recently joined them. Fascinating, he would say, as Harry talked him through using a telephone. Ingenious, really, how many ways Muggles have found of getting along without magic. And yet, Mr. Weasley, y'all use owls to carry letters, and you don't have any other solution. You can't put your wand up to your ear and have a chat with someone instantly. You gotta do letters. I mean, I guess you could apparate, but also, there should be an in-between from apparating and hoping they're not in the shower and sending them a letter by owl. That's the thing. In book one, this is when it really came up for me, is when they decided that Norbert had to go. So Ron sent an owl to Charlie. And then Charlie sent an owl back to Ron to say, yeah, I think my friends can help you out as long as you can get to the highest tower. Let me know if that'll work for you. And then Ron sent an owl back to Charlie to say, yeah, that works. And then Charlie sent an owl back to Ron to let him know, okay, I'm gonna contact my friends so that they'll do it. Let me contact them. And then he sent an owl to his friends, who sent an owl back to him. Just hit the mic, sorry if you heard that. Who sent an owl back to him. And then he sent an owl back to Ron to let him know we're all a go. And this all had to happen very, very quickly. They had to write ASAP because they needed to get rid of the dragon right away. But cell phones would be cool. And I understand that Rowling has said that because of the enchantments that they have around Hogwarts and all the magical properties, you can't have technology there. Cool. Great. Awesome. That doesn't really mean anything for when you're outside of Hogwarts, like in Arthur's situation. And plus two, also, Arthur went to Hogwarts, so he knows how archaic everything is, even if you want to say that all the owl stuff is confined solely to Hogwarts, which we know it's not. He knows how archaic that is. Why does he think a telephone is such, like, an odd thing that Muggles have used to deal with not having magic, when what they use is way worse? Oh yeah, this one's a little bit too much, even I'll say. People have brought up plenty the fact that the entrance to the Chamber of Secrets, it doesn't really work because it's in a girl's bathroom, but Hogwarts was established long before indoor plumbing. So J.K. Rowling commented on this, and she said, well, the Chamber of Secrets was actually originally a hidden trap door with a series of magical tunnels. But then, when plumbing was installed into Hogwarts, this one fella, who happened to be a Parselmouth, found the Chamber of Secrets and then managed to protect it from being destroyed somehow while the plumbing was installed. Okay, fine. But Tom Riddle is repeatedly said throughout this book that he is the most intelligent wizard that has ever entered Hogwarts. And then he says, probably the only two, he's talking about him and Harry, probably the only two Parselmouths to come to Hogwarts since the great Slytherin himself. If you're the smartest guy that's ever entered the school, surely you would have noticed, hey, the Chamber of Secrets doesn't make sense to be in a girl's bathroom because plumbing hasn't always existed. Maybe someone else has come along who knew how to speak Parseltongue, who knew how to use this nonsense. Even I admit it, Parseltongue doesn't sound as good with an American accent. Okay, last little nitpicky thing that I want to talk about before I get into all the plot conveniences, which are a much bigger problem to me than any of this stuff right here, is just that I don't understand why there's not an abundance of basilisks. The way to create them is so simple. You have to have, what is it? Is it a chicken's egg that's hatched underneath a toad? So why not everybody that has an evil agenda, just Imperius curse Imperio, a bunch of toads, get some chicken eggs, hatch some basilisks. It just seems like such a simple way to create such an evil creature that I don't really understand why it's such a novel creature. All right, now let's move on to the big ones. So this isn't plot holes, it's not stuff that doesn't fit right, it's just convenience upon convenience upon convenience, and truly, it's what makes this book my least favorite. The first one, and the only isolated one, is the car in the Forbidden Forest. So the kids are trapped. They are going to be eaten by a whole lot of spiders. And then this magical car that they flew to Hogwarts and then that abandoned them, it just drives in to the rescue, plows down a bunch of spiders, opens up its doors, the kids get in, and it drives back off, and it rescues them. So I don't love this one because this car, there's been no indication before they got to Hogwarts, there's been no indication that this car is sentient. It's been sitting in a shed for years, and then all the different times that the Ron mentions that the twins have driven it multiple times, Ron drove it, like all this time, we've never really had any indication that this car can think for itself, and yet suddenly it's barreling through spiders and rescuing the kids at the last hour because they're not capable of rescuing themselves. This one doesn't bother me as much, I just don't like it. But the ones that bother me are in the Chamber of Secrets. So once again, just like in the forest, Harry is in a situation where he is defeated. He loses. He, for whatever reason, the kid goes into a chamber where he knows there's a basilisk that kills people, and he chucks his wand to the side when he sees Ginny. No reason to chuck it, really. Just put it in your pocket. But he chucks it, and then Tom picks it up. So now Harry is trapped with Tom, who has his wand, and a basilisk. Harry's not gonna win. So what happens? Fox, which also doesn't sound as good with an American accent, flies in to save the day in a million of convenient ways. The exact right bird, who has the exact right powers, flies in with the exact hat that will provide Harry with the sword that is made of the exact material that will kill the basilisk. But even that's not good enough. Harry is, after the hat has been delivered to Harry, Harry doesn't use it. Harry then gets trapped by the basilisk, and the basilisk, as large of a creature it is, starts flailing when Fox pokes his eyes out, and the tail of the basilisk flicks the hat and puts it back in Harry's lap for the second time. Then Harry puts the hat on and pulls the sword out, and it's made of the exact material that it takes in order to kill said basilisk, and then the fang of the basilisk gets embedded into Harry's arm. When Harry pulls his arm away, the fang, rather than coming out of his arm, comes out of the basilisk's mouth, which doesn't really work. But either way, the basilisk's tooth is loose, so it comes out into Harry's arm, and then this fang happens to be the exact thing that you need in order to kill the diary, and Harry just thinks, hey, yo, we should stab it. And then this exact right bird cries on Harry's arm, and it happens to be exactly what Harry needed in order to be healed of the poison that was killing him, which I guess is why Harry the Horcrux didn't get destroyed by the basilisk venom, because the bird tears counteracted what it did to the diary. So, you know, Harry the Horcrux stays Harry the Horcrux. And then after Harry has been healed of this venom, then Harry and Ginny go back to where Ron and Lockhart are, and then this bird has the strength to carry four humans out of the tunnel by its tail feathers. It's just a myriad of, and then this perfect thing happened, and this perfect thing happened, and this perfect, it's one thing after another of plot conveniences. In general, I don't really like plot conveniences. I personally prefer for characters to fight for things and to earn things as opposed to things being handed to them. And in this last sequence, about 50 different things were handed to Harry. And that's what's so frustrating to me is in the two big scenarios. See, okay, let me back up a little bit. In book one, Harry and the gang fight hard to get to where they got to in the end. They had to use their logic, they had to play to their personal strengths, and they had to have a lot of resilience in order to do all that they did. And then in book two, the two times that they face a really great threat, both times they're cornered and they lose, and then plot convenience. Neither big thing that they face against do they get out of by any ounce of their own strength. The car thing I could dismiss. It sucks that Ron and Harry couldn't get their way out of it on their own, but whatever, sometimes a thinking for itself car gets there for you. But in the end, when he's facing Voldy, and it's not one big plot convenience that gets him out of something that he can't get out of on his own, but it's the bird, and then the hat, and then the sword, and then the fang, and then the tears, and then the tail feathers. It's so many perfect scenarios piled on top of each other that just creates this cluster cuss of conveniences that solves and saves the day. I really don't want to come off like I'm trying to be really harsh on the book or I'm trying to, you know, act like this book is terrible or anything like that. I want these videos to be fairly lighthearted, just like, you know, this thing that we love, it's not perfect because nothing is perfect, but hey, it's fun to chat about. Because that's truly how I feel about this series. Nobody writes a perfect book, and I love this series so much. And I don't want this series to come off like I'm bashing Harry Potter, because that's not how I feel whatsoever. But this is the book that frustrates me the most because of the series of conveniences that are piled on top of each other. But that doesn't even make me not like the book. I still really enjoy the book. I just wish the ending were different. Anyway, that's the video. If you didn't watch my review where I talked about the things that I loved about this book, please do check it out. Also check out my videos for book one, and I will continue to do these throughout the rest of the series. But I'd love to hear what you guys' thoughts on any of these, as well as if you noticed any of them, if you see them a little bit differently. I post videos every Sunday, Tuesday, Thursday, and Saturday. I'll see you guys again soon. Bye.